You appreciate your foot. Thank you. Well, you're all here for something, I wonder what. My goodness. Galatians 6:4 says, be sure you're doing the very best job you can possibly do. Remind yourself of that often. Do the best job you can possibly do. And then the second part of that verse says, and then you don't have to compare yourself to anybody else. That's great. And so if I ask somebody to do something, he won't probably want to say, no, I'm not good enough, or, the other person can do a better job or whatever. Do the best job you can possibly do. That's a unique thing. The Lord can use our abilities and our talents if we give him our best, wherever that is. Too many of us maybe fall short of that. And so this is called a workshop. That means I'm supposed to teach you something, but I've got a feeling that you know it all already. No?
We used to know it all.
Yeah.
When we were 14 or 15.
Yeah, yeah. Sure. Of different things, just a little bit. I want you to be sure you know. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. All right, sing it very softly, but with a lot of energy. It looks. Wait a minute, okay? Close your eyes.
I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me.
Sing the glory, hallelujah.
Jesus lived in me.
It's obvious you all have sung a lot. And so it's not like just a regular church choir that I go. Oh, do you? That's terrific. Now, I want you to think about keywords. We're going to talk a little bit about communicating. We will eventually talk about blend and enunciation and some other things. But I want right now to talk about communication. There is nothing more important, nothing, than communicating, getting it across. Now, if I had to take singing it great or communicating great, I guess I'd have to admit, sometimes hard for a musician to admit some of these things, I would want you to communicate because that's really what it's all about. But there's no excuse for sloppiness in other areas either. I say that strongly. But we're talking about communication. I can think of a group that doesn't sing well enough. They don't rehearse well enough, I think. But my, do they communicate. They have tears, I think it's genuine, and they communicate and they touch hearts. And then I can think of some college, university choirs and some others that sing fabulous. And they know nothing about communication. And that's a shame too, isn't it? So don't sing too loudly. Now, if you can sort of blend it and get yourself in balance with each other and so forth, I'm so glad. Communication is what you do largely on the key words. The first key word really is glad. Okay, say glad.
Glad.
Oh, no, look glad at the same time. Some of you look like you swallowed a dill pickle or something. My word, I'm so glad. Now when you get to that word, I'm not going to probably tell you anything you don't already know, but reminders. Sandy Patty, she sings fine, but when she gets back home, she has a vocal coach, a coach that helps her with different things, and I think, why does Sandy Patty need any more help? But apparently she thinks she does sometimes, and other top artists do too. And so when they get home, they work with the coach. Andre Agassi and these fine people, they all have coaches. And I think, now I wonder, where does the coach start with a guy like Andre Agassi? You know, it seems like he pretty much knows how to do it. It would be so embarrassing to get beaten by some of those girls, Venus and Serena, you know? Oh my goodness, do they want the ball well? Anyway, how did I get on that? So, I'm so glad. When you get to the word glad, something happens. If you were going, you just ran into the room and you said, man, I'm so glad our team won last night. And on the word glad, something would happen. Maybe your smile would get bigger, your eyes might get a little wider, you look at me a little stronger. You tell it with the whole body. Practice the word glad, okay? Look at me with your eyes.
I'm so glad.
The word glad, something happens.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad. Now I want to see that come alive when you get to it. We'll come back to it. The next key word is what? Jesus. For obvious reasons. Say softly, but say Jesus.
Jesus.
Now, we might say Jesus who is powerful and so forth, and that would have one connotation. Or we might even say it very softly with energy. Let's say it that way.
Jesus.
All right, so the word Jesus is different than the word glad. We're going to communicate them both, but we want to try to find that which fits the word. Now, eye contact, okay? Regular church choirs, they have a terrible time doing this. And they just kind of want to look my direction. And I'm talking about connecting with eyes. You know how important that is. Now, when you have a director, you communicate, you look at the director, and when you're looking at somebody and connecting with eyes, it seems that it works for the whole. But if I'm not looking at anybody, I say, now I'm going to tell you something. You ought to become a Christian. That's why work does it. They have to hit with the eyes. You. And if I make my eyes reach somebody, it seems to work with the rest. I'm so glad. There's one key word we're going to think about. Jesus is another.
I'm so glad. Jesus.
Jesus. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Say it again.
Jesus. I'm so glad. Jesus with me. I'm so glad. Jesus with me.
Jesus lifted. He lifted. You can remember when you were, before you were a Christian, when you were, so to speak, down in the gutter of sin. And life was bad. I don't know your story, but without Christ, it was pretty bad. Huh? And he reached down and he picked you up and he lifted you. Now that helped. That doesn't hurt to give a little of that. But put some energy behind that word. Make it lift. Jesus lifted. Lifted. Practice that word as well. Now we're not going to neglect the other one, but
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me.
He was about 90 years old. Remember, Merkel was Pop. We called him Pop. And he was just old time. And he'd get so blessed sometimes in the middle of the message, and he'd just say, glory! Oh my, if they did that at my Baptist church now. People get so nervous, they say, what is going on now? Glory! And my goodness, it just made you feel like you wanted to get into the service more. Glory, just the way he said it, and he had a good old sound of that glory too. I don't know, he just knew how to do it. Singing glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Sing the whole song.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad
of you to stand up, would you? Face each other in twos. So if it doesn't come out that way, find a two, would you? Not three, but two, if possible. If you can, find a two. If you can. All right.
I'll switch with you.
All right. All right, here's what we're going to do. All right. Now, this is very meaningful when I do it with my church choir, but it can be helpful, I think, to you, too. It's just one-on-one, two people, okay? And you're going to use eye contact. Oh, my wife said that was the hardest thing I ever had to do. So I had eyes of my husband, you know. So eye contact. Now, the person more on this side, look, the person more on that side of every two is doing the communicating. Got it? The person on this side is the mirror. This person is doing the communicator. And this person is the mirror of what this person is doing. If this person looks grumpy, this person looks grumpy, and the moods will change depending on the word and so forth. But the idea is the mirrors are supposed to help the person doing the communicating a little bit to know how to know what's happening. And sometimes, it's like I told you about the other side. He said, I am communicating. I am smiling. And my, this wasn't working out a bit. And so, communicator, if the mirror is giving you a message, see what you can do about it, okay? To the eyes, one on one.
Jesus, look at me.
It might be that the mirrors were a little kind once in a while. I don't know. I want this side to do this communicating. This is the mirror.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me.
Truly are doing well. I got to tell you, as a whole, I think you are doing very well, and you know the importance of communication. But
what?
A lot of people around you don't know it, and so let's project it. I've noticed that, for instance, I have a granddaughter who sings so well and who communicates, but. She was singing with a fellow once who wasn't much of a communicator, and I noticed that he was pulling her down. She was doing a little bit more like he was. And I said, now listen, B, you do what you know you're supposed to do, and maybe he'll pick up a little bit. Who knows? The communication. All right, the hymn. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches deem my account but loss and poor contempt and all my pride. So, it's maybe a little easier to communicate in a sense. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me, just a bouncy little jazzy song than it is maybe on something like When I Survey the Wonders. But same thing. Wondrous is a key word, right? Say wondrous.
Wondrous.
With your eyes, say.
Wondrous.
On which the Prince. What does that mean? Positive and sacred.
Yes.
Of glory that he died. my richest land and so forth. It's an invitation. Let me give you a few other words and say them. If we were singing, get on the side, you can tell excited. Say excited.
Excited.
Say it softly, but say
excited.
All right, say the word powerful. Totally different. Powerful. Say it.
Powerful.
Quite different than excited. Say it again.
Powerful.
Say strong.
Strong.
Say rivers.
Rivers.
Say alive.
Alive.
Yeah. Say dead.
Dead.
Oh, you got it. Yeah, very good. All right. I want you to breathe. Put your hands behind your head. Would you like this? Come down. With your elbows down towards your knees. Don't hit your head on something here, but come down, okay? Come down. Now, take a deep breath. Notice when you take your breath, what happens? Your diaphragm expands, right?
Yeah.
Take a deep breath. Take in the air. Let the air out, the diaphragm returns. Wow. Yes?
I just had a lot of diaphragm.
I'm staying away from that, thank you. Now, if you look at a little baby lying down, little baby breathes correctly. Takes in air, diaphragm expands. If you're lying on your back, you're breathing, you take in air, then your diaphragm expands. But you say to a choir many times, take a deep breath, and you try to do it just opposite. Take a deep breath. Through the S, make the S sound with your T. Take a breath. Feel this expand. Big breath. When we sing, we're singing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, many of us take little gulping too fast breaths. And so, comprehend the intervals. sing 1, 3, 5, 3.
1, 3, 5, 3, 1.
1, 2, 5, 2, 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Watch me.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
I really didn't want 8 right now. I just wanted you to think 8, so you got the right 7. You wouldn't send 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's something else. 7. Sing 1, 7, 1.
1, 7, 1.
1, 4, 1.
1, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 4, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6, 1, 1, 6
127.
127.
Now you may say, when do I ever use this? Well, I practice a lot of stuff in the car. I don't practice intervals too much anymore because I really know them. I can do 1 4 7 6, 2 4 7 5 6, 3 5 1 2 4 3 6, and so forth. That's easy, I think. But practice it. At the end of a Dino concert once, I heard a lady come up and say, "Oh, I just love the way you play the piano." Said, "I would give anything to be able to play like you do." And he said, "Are you willing to practice 6 hours a day?" There is a price for perfection. Oh my, these concert artists, you know, it is something. And some of us wouldn't have the to get to the place they are. I respect them for practicing that little simple little figure for hours at a time. And so in the car, practice your intervals. And then you can, if this is C, you can do the same thing, C, E, A, F, G, B, B, C, C, B, F. Do I have perfect pitch? No, I don't. And do I want it? I really don't. I respect people who have it, and there are pros and cons. Our organist at one of my church, I said, "Now, Walt, what notes am I playing?" He said, "Well, that's an E flat, a G, an A flat, and an A." That's absolutely amazing. What notes am I playing? He said, "That's a C sharp, and a C, and a D." Well, that's pretty good, don't you think? And you know, a person that's got perfect pitch, if it's a typical church piano, it's a little flat, he's got to start transposing everything. Or if it's a choir singing a cappella and the choir starts going down a little bit, he's got to start making terrible adjustments. So I have good relative pitch. And wherever you are, hone it up. But intervals are very, very important. Something else. Bass, sing it. I don't want a bullfrog. Drop your jaw down. Open your throat. Sing ooh. Tenors. Like front. Bass has got a half step. Soprano's got it. You tell me, listen to yourself. Tenor's up a half step. Let's continue with our blend just a little bit. If somebody says blend more, we're basically talking about the vowels, what you do with the vowels. The placement and the pronunciation, the vowels. Some goddess so good. Find the harmony part. Just an ooh.
Thank you. to change when you open one up.
No.
They don't want to change. The other NG that just buzzes rings right up in here, okay? And find, you've been in the shower sometime when you sing a certain note and man, you say, boy, it sounds like Pavarotti. This doesn't happen too often. I think I said Elvis once or twice. I don't know. But, just in a word, if you want to blend more, what do you do? There's another word I'd like to remember. What you do with the vowels. The vowels. Placement and enunciation of the vowels. If somebody is singing home, sweet home, 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 and someone else is, oh, it won't be a good blend because the vowel is not totally. If you want to enunciate more, how many times have I said to a choir, enunciate more? They'll say, oh, okay. They'll do it again, doesn't sound any different than the time before. Because you have to know what to do to enunciate. Well, this is something that we could work for weeks and weeks and months and beyond. And so I just want to touch on a few little things. You may be ready to have it perfected now, but I think it's a lifetime experience of perfection. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the peace of the Lord lay, the first word is when. Think about it for a minute. What's the first sound that you say on a W word? Somebody said what? Who is the answer? What is more than one sound? So the word when is who, eh? why. Because so a W word starts with a we haven't gotten to passing it yet, but this is still part of the vowel. But a choir would be well to know that any W word starts with a A Y starts with a what? A Y word, right? Y E S. What? E. Why would someone speak with E? A W word starts with an O. Huh? I'm talking about when I survey. Wondrous. Wondrous. What's the first sound of the word wondrous? It's a O. Okay? N is an important sound. There are certain letters, certain consonants that don't sound pretty for us to emphasize. R is one, doesn't sound pretty to make a big deal of the R or the S. Sometimes we say to the choir, sing an N or sing an U or something. I never heard a choir director say, okay, let's all sing S together. That would not be good, would it? Would not be good. But an N is a pretty sound. And we want to build the sound of it. So, there's an N. So when we get to the N, we want to sing it louder and longer. About as long as your wet finger touching a hot iron. Short S. I'm not going to say sir. Some states, they just talk that way. Sir. I was doing a vocal workshop once for people from a lot of different countries, France and so forth. And I was trying to tell them some of this kind of stuff, and I realized, Skillings, this is silliness. We come from so many different backgrounds, we don't have the same, there's some things just put their own choir director to teach them. So we won't sing survey, but we'll sing S-U-H. There'll be enough of an R that will make it fun, okay? Vay. Kind of tickles a little bit, actually. If we want to enunciate that part of the word, we need to sing through the V. Same pitch on the V. But then we don't want to have the, we don't want to bounce the vowel after that. V, we don't want A, we want so we want to emphasize the V with the E's in the vowel. The TH is another that we'll sing. Sing pitch, sing the TH. Sing the. Just hold the first part. I don't want to bounce off of the F vowel. Sing TH. Next word, what's the next sound you make? Ooh. Ooh, then you go to the end. We haven't gotten to the S yet. The S is short. That's some of the things you think about when we're talking about enunciation. You say, man, that sounds weird. sounds wonderful. If the choir spends time working on it and all starts thinking alike. Probably have sung the song about Andy at church. Andy walks your hand, he talks your hand. And so you need age. Oh, I've heard lots of choirs sing Andy. Andy walks, or there's a the gravy song. Low in the gravy. Things to think about. Right? Oh, yeah.
Well, the next resurrection, you better crack it up like 7 minutes. Oh,
I know. Choirs do a lot of things, they don't know it. I always hate it when they sing and lead us not to. I didn't want to put that one on the mic so
much. We
missed it. Just talk about staggered breathing for a minute. I like, especially on hymns and songs of that sort, I like to be sure we're breathing in a way that corresponds to the words. Average choirs often would sing, "When I survey the wondrous cross, one which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss." But really, truly, it's all one sentence. When I survey the wondrous cross, on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and 14, it's all one sentence. And I like to sing it that way. And so let's do it. When you stagger your breathing, it means you don't want to breathe
in a place that anybody else is breathing. Well, obviously, that's not going to quite work here, this many people. But nobody will breathe at the end of the phrase. Okay. Try a little bit of it. Blend. Now, we've got all of those perfect now, right? Breathe big, like we thought about a while ago, okay? First song we sing is an ooh, but I'm especially thinking now on a staggering air breathing. We'll breathe quietly because we don't want anybody else to realize we're breathing at an unusual place. Try the little hands up routine. We're going to sing this this way, staggering our breathing. I'll sing it out to you. I'm not asking so much for love, but I'm asking for intensity. But when you're actually breathing, not making a sound, put your hand up like this. As soon as you're back in, put your hand back down again. We can see how we're coming, okay? Understand? So simple, but if all the choir is one, it keeps it coming. Or I love big endings too. And the tempers go bum bum bum, and we build up a little more, and we build, and I love those too. I like long endings. And if you run out, very simple. Get another breath.
Seems so simple.
good. I didn't hear it, but I'll bet it was good. Well, some of you have really nice, significant vibratos. Maybe some of you don't have a vibrato. I don't know. I've auditioned people before, many times, and someone will sing, "Swing low, sweet chariot." I'll say, "Very nice, thank you." Now, could you sing it with no vibrato? I said, "Sure, no problem." Now go, "Swing low, sweet chariot." You know you have a vibrato there. I do, I really do. Well, if you've honed that in you all of your life, it's not necessarily easy to get out. And you might say, well, why take it out? Some songs demand no vibrato. If it's a close harmony kind of a thing, tight chords, it might be really nice with no vibrato. Spurlows used to sing with no vibrato much of the time. If it's more of a traditional kind of a song, some vibrato, but you don't have to overdo it either. Or it might, some of the pop kind of songs, or Sandy Patty, sort of, you know, hold it straight for a while, and then they'll just start to let it go a little bit, warm it up on the end. That's great. What can we try? Let's do it on, go back to God is so good. Words, I guess, but no. No. Like what? See, how do I go about that? Well, I don't know. For one thing, sing with more energy. Push it. Push the vibrato out of it. If, like Bernice in my choir, she had a big, big vibrato. And, boy, she had a terrible time getting it out. And if she would start to retreat and say, oh, I just know there's going to be vibrato, the more she'd retreat, the more vibrato there was. I don't know why I'm looking at you. There's no reason to. These things so lovely. But you have to make the tone go somewhere. That's not saying it has to be louder, but it has to be energy that makes it go somewhere. From here to there. Make it go somewhere. Sing. God is no, my God. Thank you. I gotta tell you a little personal story, and I think this is the silliest thing in the world for me to tell you. You'll notice on this picture there, I've got a lot of hair. And you'll notice I've got a lot of hair here too. And, you know, a couple little boys at my church, true story. And one of the little boys, they didn't say this to me, they were saying this to each other, and I heard about it. And one of them said, "Did you know that Otis Skillings is bald?" Which is not entirely true. Now, I want to tell you that. And the other one said, "No, said he's bald, said he doesn't have hardly any hair at all." And the other one said, "No, he's got more hair than I got." And the first little boy said, "No, said he's bald, said he wears a tattoo." Isn't it cute? Oh, now you don't know if I do or not. Yeah, my goodness. Well, okay. I would love for you to remember all the techniques that we thought about, which are breathing, and enunciation, and blending, and so forth. But I usually like to sing through it once and not stop. But we may stop a few times this first time. Introduction. This is Praise God for Whom All Blessings Flow, in a little different meter.
Thank you.
sorry you're not breathing good. I'll just say as a general rule, let's don't breathe anywhere unless there's a breath or rest, or the director directs, and he'll probably only be directing. So some of you sun, but quite obvious, okay? Where are we? I've lost my focus. Go back to praise.
Praise the Lord.
Ready? Praise the Lord.
sopranos is not high, but do that obligato part on the next day.
You know what makes me think of the story? It was a true story, some football coach, I forget which one it was. And he realized that there were 12 men on the field, football. And somehow another got word, and so the quarterback said, "Now, when we do this, I want one of you to drop off the end." You know, so and no one maybe knows. About half the team dropped off. You know. And so when I say a few sopranos, I don't know what that means. That might mean you all volunteer.
What's the difference between a soprano and a terrorist?
Oh, tell me.
You can negotiate with a terrorist.
She's got more, but come on, let's sing the second verse. Are you ready? The second verse. Ready? Here we go. Amen. Let's go back for thine. Unison. Sometimes I think that writers don't need to write anymore. Just let's take some things off that's not so hot and bring back some of the good things. Now, this may be a partial answer, but Charles Wesley, for instance, wrote 6,000 songs, and we still have 15, 20 of them in many of our hymn books. And it might make sense to think that those that were among the best ones are the ones that remain, maybe. And so maybe that was one of the tests, maybe. So if this is one of the good ones, maybe it remains, and maybe Temple will say, hey, yep, we still got to be able to put it. I don't know. I don't know what we need to think of that. Okay, we're going to sing it from the beginning, okay? Don't fall asleep. Sing it with your whole heart. Make it come alive.
Can you stand?
Sure you can stand. If you could try to see through here, it would be helpful. No, I've lost some of you in the back.
The short people in the back really can't see.
Okay, are you ready?
Yeah.
Thank you.
thank you.
Thank you.
Now, for just a minute, okay? Give me another 5 minutes.
You got it.
Oh, my. Well, thank you. Well, there are so many things in a workshop we could talk about. The way you dress, the way you stand, the way you walk in, that you don't... how many church choirs have you seen? And they come in, and then someone will talk out of the side of the mouth, we'll go for a little bit. Right? Oh. Yeah. And so... they don't know what happened, but you really are worship leaders. And then Jordan starts the offertory. You look right there. The elder the Lord. And the congregation is more likely than to do the same thing. What's the point of action? You don't ever put your hands up to scratch your face. You don't do that, do you? You don't talk. You don't go and then you come back. Do you? I was like, you never want to do that. And so someone says, well, what if it just comes? If you know you can't, you find a way to get around it. You're still watching the director, and if you have to clear your throat, and you find a way to do it. But you don't see professional groups on TV or dancers or something in the middle of the routine. They go, and they go back to the routine. Those are just kind of important things to remember. When somebody comes up at the end and says, oh, that was wonderful. Loved it. Big blessing. You would not ever say, oh, I made a mistake tonight. You don't ever acknowledge that. You don't need to. If they said something like they enjoyed it, it was a blessing, it means it was. Don't ruin it for them. And keep your positive attitude. Just say, I'm glad it was a blessing. Bless your heart. Thank you. That's great. That's great. But, practice or think about how to receive a compliment. Well, there's so many things we could say that way. When you sing in church, it might be easy to think, if you were singing at the rescue mission, obvious down and outers, you think, man, this is a ministry. But then you sing at another church and everyone looks so nice. They're all sitting there in their ties or whatever. Not so much anymore, maybe, but and you might think, you know, if we were down at the rescue mission, it would really be a ministry. But I don't know what you think now, that you don't verbalize it. But it is ministry time. And there's not a person in that congregation that doesn't need to be ministry to, including you and the person sitting next to you. Two shoe salesmen went to Africa to check out the market for selling shoes. And when they got there, one of them called the head office back here in Connecticut and said, I'm coming right home. These people don't wear shoes. The other one called back and said, send thousands. So they don't wear shoes. And one of them realized immediately, and so we have to realize every group that we sing to needs to hear what we've got. So sing with that kind of voice. Well, I don't want to turn it into a revival meeting or anything. It's okay. You are a wonderful group. I have just been so blessed at hearing you and watching you and getting this meeting. Thank you. I think we'll close with prayer. Huh? Thank you, Father, for this time together. Forgiving is a song in our heart. I'm absolutely convinced that there are going to be many, many, many people in heaven because of the message that we sing. Continue to make it true. And wherever we are in our own communities, our choirs, whatever we're doing, may we be a blessing to others and may we remember that people need to hear. Thank you for opportunities. Thank you for this time together. Give you praise. I give you praise. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for turning your music in. Maybe you have already. Well, it is about 3:03. I didn't know if I could think of enough stuff to go to 3, but I think I did 1 to 6. Thank you.
Otis is quite a guy. I've had the pleasure of knowing him maybe a day long for most of you. He actually flew into town on Thursday, and the reunion committee got there on Thursday night and spent the evening at my house and brought him to Friday. Did you enjoy last night, Otis?
And then you go out there, and it's really interesting because he is known if you look at the websites there.
Truly, do you recognize this language? I guess we need to start with Swedish. Right down there, musical by Otis, Skillings, and Walk with God. And before I get into this, I'm going to give you one little thing. We are really honored to have Otis and be able to come to our campus. We really appreciate it. Very special on here. Some things that have happened that you don't know about. I'm just getting over the guy and hope it's all fun. We made arrangements with Otis. And in a second we'll see what was happening during the same time frame. And then we found out about 6 months ago, you had a bowel cancer. And then we started getting those and started running for it. And the news went to you guys about it, we mentioned it. And last week he was in San Diego, and he's in the hospital with his sister. And he's here with us.
Oh, here comes Jay. something of the short and simple and hopefully easy to remember, life seemed like it. And then a little while after that, I wrote Love, and then someone said, now what's the next one? Are you going to pursue happiness? Well, didn't turn out that way, but it was something like 1969. Good Life and Tell It Like It Is had been written, and they didn't go on the rock musicals, because that was a thing some of the saints, you know? So they go on the folk musicals. They didn't all sound like folk music, but that's what they called them, folk musicals. And then a man named Jesse Peterson came to me and said, Otis, why don't you write one? Well, I didn't think I really wanted to. It sounded to me kind of, I don't know, it didn't sound like it was me exactly. And he said, I think it really could be an important thing that could be used by a lot of groups. Like the new life singers, I'm not quite put it that way, but he said, I wish you would really consider it. And so I listened to Tell It Like It Is a couple of times. You know it, don't you? Pass it on, it's in there, drop it on, like a third title and so forth. And I liked it, but I thought, well, I'll give it a try. I'll write something that maybe will kind of have my personality, whatever that might be. And so I started writing. In the meantime, Jesse Peterson was kind of a contact person between me and himself and Lillian's publishing company. Lillian's had not yet agreed to publish it. This was controversial. You know, Lillian's was kind of a little slightly traditional, or I might use the word stuffy, don't tell them I said that. And you know, we were just not so sure. They really were going to say, yes, let's do it. We were kind of hoping it might just be a little bit too much for this publishing company. And I remember I was living in San Diego when Jesse flew in one day, and when I saw him, the first thing he said is, I think you probably just might as well forget it, not do it. Because he had been just a little discouraged. It just didn't seem like it was flowing along with the company. And I said, Jesse, let's don't give up yet. Let's just, it seemed like we had talked a little too far. And it wasn't too much after that that it seemed like things were moving a little better for life to maybe be published. So it wasn't finalized yet. Things like this were not easy in that day. Well, the next plan was, Otis would finish the writing, and then Jesse would get to go to Kansas City and sing it, one person, solo band, for all the main guys at Lillian's, let them hear it, and then they would have to make a decision whether or not they were comfortable doing it. Well, he had kind of arranged it already, where either they would agree to accept it all as it is, or none, but not pick this song and this song and this little thing and so forth, which would have been awkward. Well, I appreciated that because I didn't want a bunch of executives sort of picking my thing apart. I just assumed they didn't take it all. Well, so I flew into Kansas City. There were about six or eight of these fellows, kind of the top guys of Lillian's, all except the president, the main top guy. And so I sat in the room that morning and sang Life. To have life, it would be a moment. So, well, they listened to it. I went right through, did all the talking parts and all, every song. It's contagious. Phony. Guys kind of went, that was nice. And I thought, my goodness, is that the best you can muster up? Well, I told you that the president was not in the meeting at the time. He had another thing. And so he had said he would be available so I started all over again when I taught the afternoon, sang the same thing, all of the talking parts. I said, what other heaven are we going to do? You know all those little things. And I had it down real well. As soon as it was spinning, he jumped up and said,
for the orchestra.
the tapes back to Los Angeles and add voices with our American people, but they had an English there all ready to go. I thought this just doesn't sound like it's going to work. We're not going to send a music choir, musical, with a bunch of adult British singers, you know, that's some real stuff. But I thought, well, we'll try a little bit of it. If it doesn't work, it's just a lesson we learned, and we'll take the tape back and we'll go back to plan A. Well, we got into it, and the group was amazingly able to flex on the song, "What is the answer?" There's an answer. You know, it's a British group. And I said, "Oh, so answer." And they learned how to do it pretty well. Now, knowing that, if you go back and listen to the recording, you probably wouldn't be able to tell that it's a British group. But I don't think most people would know otherwise. They did really all right. I was weak, and we kept the British voices. And that's the way it got recorded. Well, that's scared me half to death. Did a premiere of it in Kansas City.
Thank you for the privilege of sharing with you. God bless you.